ऑसिलेटर्स सेकेंड यूनिट इन इलेक्ट्रॉनिक सर्किट टू. वॉट इज ऑसिलेटर? ऑसिलेटर इज नथिंग बट इलेक्ट्रॉनिक सर्क्यूट दैट जनरेट एन आउटपुट सिग्नल विदाउट द नेसेसिटी ऑफ एन इनपुट सिग्नल. इट प्रोड्यूसेस ए पीरियाडिक वेवफॉर्म ऑन इट्स आउटपुट विथ ओनली द डीसी सप्लाई वोल्टेज एज एन इनपुट. The output voltage can be either sinusoidal or non-sinusoidal depending on the type of oscillator. So here we have different types of oscillator which produce various type of outputs including sine wave, square wave, triangular wave and sawtooth waves. This is the basic block diagram or oscillator diagram. So from the oscillator, from the figure we can observe we are receiving the DC supply voltage for the oscillator to produce the sine wave, square wave and triangular wave. So here the oscillator can be of two types. Feedback oscillator. So one type of oscillator is the feedback oscillator which turns a fraction of the output signal to the input with no net phase shift, resulting in a reinforcement of the output signal. After oscillations are started, the loop gain is maintained at 1 to maintain oscillation. A feedback oscillator consists of an amplifier for gain. Either a discrete transistor or an op amp can be used, and a positive feedback circuit that produces phase shift and provides attenuation, which is shown in the figure. And second type of oscillator is the relaxation oscillator. So instead of feedback, a relaxation oscillator uses an RC timing circuit to generate a waveform that is generally a square wave or other non-sinusoidal waveform. Typically, a relaxation oscillator uses a Schmitt trigger or other device that changes states to alternately charge and discharge a capacitor through a resistor. Relaxation oscillators are discussed in next section. So now we are going to see about the feedback oscillators. So feedback oscillator operation is based on the principle of positive feedback. So here we are going to look the general condition which is required for the oscillation to occur. So feedback oscillators are widely used to generate sinusoidal waveforms. So positive feedback, a portion of the output voltage of an amplifier is fed back to the input with no net phase shift, resulting in a strengthening of the output signal. This basic idea is illustrated in the diagrams. So as you can see, the in phase feedback voltage is amplified to produce the output voltage, which turn produces the feedback voltage. That is, a loop is created in which the signal maintains itself and a continuous sinusoidal output is produced. This phenomenon is said to be oscillation. In some types of amplifiers, the feedback circuit shift the phase and an inverting amplifier is required to provide another phase shift so that there is no net phase shift. This is illustrated in the second diagram. The next conditions, two conditions which is required for the oscillation to sustain the state of oscillation, we require first point, the phase shift around the feedback loop must be effectively zero. The voltage gain ACL, that is closed loop gain, around the closed feedback loop gain must be equal to unity. The voltage gain around the closed feedback loop is the product of the amplifier gain and the attenuation beta of the feedback circuit. That is CL equal to AV beta. If a sinusoidal wave is the desired output, a loop gain greater than 1 will rapidly causes the output to saturate at both peaks of the waveform, producing unacceptable distortion. To avoid this, some form of gain control must be used to keep the loop gain at exactly 1 once oscillations have been started. For example, if the attenuation of the feedback circuit is 0.01, the amplifier must have a gain of exactly 100 to overcome this attenuation and not create unacceptable distortion. So that 100 into 0.01 will give you a unity value 1. An amplifier gain of greater than 100 will cause the oscillator to limit both peaks of the waveform. So, startup condition for the oscillator is, you have seen so far what it takes for an oscillator to produce a continuous sinusoidal output. Now let's examine the requirement for the oscillation to start when the DC supply voltage is first turned on. As you know, the unity gain condition must be met for oscillation to be maintained. For oscillation to begin, the voltage gain around the positive feedback loop must be greater than 1 so that the amplitude of the output can build up to a desired level. The gain must then decrease to 1 so that the output stays at the desired level and oscillation is sustained. The voltage gain condition for both starting and sustaining oscillation are illustrated in the figures. So, RC feedback circuit. There are three types of feedback oscillators that use RC circuit to produce sinusoidal outputs, or this Wien bridge oscillator, phase shift oscillator and twin T oscillator. Generally, RC feedback oscillators are used for frequency up to 1 MHz. The Wien bridge is by far the most widely used type of RC feedback oscillator for this range of frequency. So first we are going to see about the Wien bridge oscillator, which is most widely used type of RC feedback oscillator. So here this is one type of sinusoidal feedback oscillator, which is a fundamental part of the Wien bridge oscillator is lead lag circuit, which is shown in the diagram. As the frequency increases, XC2, that is capacitor 2, decreases, thus allowing the output voltage to increase. At some specified frequency, the response of the lag circuit takes over and the decreased value of XC1 causes the output voltage to decrease. The response curve for the lead lag circuit shown in the figure B indicates that the output voltage peaks at a frequency called the resonant frequency. So at this point, the attenuation of the circuit is 1 by 3 if R1 equal to R2 and capacitor C1 equal to C2. To summarize, the lead lag circuit in the Wien bridge oscillator has a resonant frequency at which the phase shift through the circuit is 0 degree and the attenuation is 1 by 3. So here these are the formulas, output voltage which will be gained in the Wien bridge oscillator circuit. So here the phase shift will be 0 for the 1 minus omega naught square R square C square, which will be equal to 0. So the basic Wien bridge uses lead lag circuit in the positive feedback loop to select a specific frequency that is amplified. So the voltage divider in the negative feedback loop sets the gain to make up for the attenuation of the feedback network. The Wien bridge oscillator circuit can be viewed from viewed as a non-inverting amplifier configuration with the input signal fed back from the output through the lead lag circuit. So So as you know, for the circuit output to oscillate, the phase shift around the positive feedback loop must be 0 degree and the gain around the loop must be equal to 180. So the 0 degree phase shift condition is met when the frequency is resonant, because the phase shift through the lead lag circuit is 0 degree and there is no inversion from the non-inverting input of the op-amp to the output. So the closed loop gain of the non-inverting amplifier is 1 plus R1 divided by R2. Since there is a loss of 1 by 3 of the signal in the positive feedback loop, the non-inverting amplifier must have a gain of exactly 3 as set by R1 and R2 to make up for the attenuation. The unity gain condition is met when R1 equal to 2R2. This is the diagram for the phase shift around the loop 0 degree and also for the voltage gain. This unity. See, this is the self-starting main bridge oscillator using JFET in the negative feedback loop. So here the gain of the op-amp is controlled by the components shown in the blue box, which include the JFET. The JFET drain source resistance depends on the gate voltage. With no output signal, the gate is at 0 volts, causing the drain source resistance to be at the minimum. With this condition, the loop gain is greater than 1. Oscillations begin and rapidly build to a large output signal. Negative output signal forward bias D1 causing capacitor C3 to charge to a negative voltage. This voltage increases the drain source resistance of the JFET and reduces the gain and hence the output. With the proper selection of the components, the gain can be stabilized at the required level. Next, we are going to see about the phase shift oscillator. So here the sinusoidal feedback oscillator which uses 3 RC circuit in each in the feedback loop can provide a maximum phase shift approaching 90 degree. So oscillation occurs at the frequency where the total phase shift through the 3 RC circuit is 180 degree. The inversion of the op-amp itself provides the additional 180 degree to meet the requirement for oscillation of a 360 degree or 0 degree phase shift around the feedback loop. The attenuation beta of the 3 section RC feedback circuit is beta equal to 1/29. To meet the greater than unity loop gain requirement, the closed loop voltage gain of the op-amp must be greater than 29. The frequency of oscillation FR is given as 1/2π√6×RC. So this is the multisim can simulate the phase shift oscillator, but has difficulty starting in the multisim file. For example, 16.3, switches provide to provide a voltage spike to start the oscillation. This is not needed in the actual circuit. So this is the example problem you can solve. So given here, this is the summary of the phase shift oscillator using multisim. The combined parallel filters produce a band stop response with a center frequency equal to the desired frequency of oscillation. Oscillations cannot occur at frequency above or below FR because of the negative feedback through the filters. At resonant frequency, however, there is negligible negative feedback. Thus, the positive feedback through the voltage divider, that is R1 and R2, allows the circuit to oscillate. Next, we are going to see the LC oscillators. Although the RC feedback oscillators, particularly the Wien bridge, are generally suitable for frequency up to about 1 MHz. LC feedback element are normally used in oscillator that require high frequency of oscillations. Also, because of the frequency limitation, that is lower unity gain frequency of most op-amp transistor, that is BJT or FET, which are often used as the gain element in the LC oscillators. This section introduces several types of resonant LC feedback oscillator like the Colpitt, Clapp, Hartley, Armstrong and crystal controlled oscillators. First we are going to see about the Colpitt oscillator. So on one basic type of resonant circuit feedback oscillator is the Colpitt oscillator. So in this type of oscillator, we uses an LC circuit in the feedback loop to provide the necessary phase shift and to act as a resonant filter that passes only the desired frequency of oscillation. So the approximate frequency of oscillation in the resonant frequency of the LC circuit and is established by the values of C1 and C2 and L according to the formula resonant frequency FR equal to 1 by 2 pi root of L CT, where C is the total capacitance, because the capacitors effectively appear in series around the tank circuit. So the total capacitance CT will be given as C1 into C2 divided by C1 plus C2. So here the condition for oscillation and startup is attenuation beta of the resonant feedback circuit in the Colpitt oscillator is basically determined by the values C1 and C2. So here the figure shows that the circulating tank current, which is through both C1 and C2 effectively in series, the voltage developed across C2 is the oscillator's output voltage and the voltage developed across C1 is the feedback voltage as indicated. So expression for the beta is C2 by C1. As you know, a condition for oscillation is beta into A must be equal to 1. Since beta equal to C2 by C1, so we can consider the gain as C1 by C2. For the oscillator to be self-starting, beta into A, that is the product of beta and A, must be greater than 1. Therefore, the voltage gain must be made slightly greater than C1 by C2. So this is the resonant frequency of a parallel resonant circuit, which depends on the Q value. It is resonant frequency is given as 1 by 2 pi root of LCT into square root of Q2 divided by Q2 plus 1. As a rule of thumb, for a Q greater than 10, the frequency is approximately equal to FR equal to 1 by 2 pi root of LCT into Q square divided by Q square plus 1 whole square root. When Q less than 10, however, resonant frequency is reduced significantly. So a FET can be used in place of a BJT to minimize the loading effect of the transistor input impedance. So recall that FET have much greater higher input impedance than the BJT. Also, when an external load is connected to the oscillator output, resonant frequency may decrease because of a Q reduced. This happens if the load resistance is too small. In some cases, one way to eliminate the effect of load resistance is by transformer coupling as indicated in the figure. This is the example for the Colpitt oscillator. You can solve by your own. Next, Clapp oscillator. So Clapp oscillator is a variation of Colpitt oscillator. The basic difference is an additional capacitor C3 in series with the inductor in the resonant feedback circuit. Since C3 is in series with the C1 and C2 around the tank circuit, the total capacitance is given by CT equal to 1 divided by 1 by C1 plus 1 by C2 plus 1 by C3. So approximate frequency of oscillation for a Q greater than 10 is given as resonant frequency FR equal to 1 by 2 pi root of LT. LC. This is the diagram of clap oscillator. So which here the clap provides a more accurate and stable frequency of oscillation. If C3 is much smaller than C1 and C2, then C3 almost entirely controls the resonant frequency. Next, we are going to see about the Hartley oscillator, which is similar to the Kolpitt oscillator, except that the feedback circuit consists of two series inductor and a parallel capacitor as shown in the diagram. In this circuit, the frequency of oscillation is FR equal to 1 by 2 pi root of LC. So here LT represent both L1 and L2 in series. The inductors act in a role similar to C1 and C2 in the Kolpitt to determine the attenuation beta of the feedback circuit. So here we can define the beta value as ratio of L1 by L2. To assure startup oscillation, gain must be greater than 1 by beta, that is A equal to L2 by L1. So loading of the tank circuit has the same effect in the Hartley as in the Kolpitt, that is the Q is decreased and thus resonant frequency also decreases. Next we are going to see about the Armstrong oscillator. This is a type of LC oscillator which uses transformer coupling to feedback a portion of the output signal. The transformer used here will provide the feedback to keep the oscillation going. The Armstrong is less common than the Kolpitt clap and Hartley oscillator, mainly because of the disadvantage of transformer size and cost. The frequency of oscillation is set by the inductance of the primary winding in parallel with the C1. Next, crystal oscillator, crystal controlled oscillator. So the most stable and accurate type of feedback oscillator uses a piezoelectric crystal in the feedback loop to control the frequency. First we have to see what is piezoelectric effect. So quartz is one of the crystalline substance found in nature that exhibits a property called the piezoelectric effect. The piezoelectric effect is nothing but when a changing mechanical stress is applied across the crystal to cause it to vibrate, a voltage develops at the frequency of mechanical vibration. Conversely, when an AC voltage is applied across the crystal, it vibrates at the frequency of the applied voltage. So the greatest vibration occurs at the crystal's natural resonant frequency, which is determined by the physical dimension and by the way the crystal is cut. Crystals used in an electronic application typically consist of a quartz wafer. So here the typical packaged crystal, basic construction of the quartz wafer symbol and its electrical equivalent circuit are represented here. As you can see, the crystal equivalent circuit is a serial parallel RLC circuit and can operate in either series resonant or parallel resonant. At the series resonant frequency, the inductive reactance is cancelled by the reactance of CS. The remaining series resistance determines the impedance of the crystal. Parallel resonance occurs when the inductive reactance and the reactance of the parallel capacitance are equal. So here the great advantage of the crystal is that it exhibits a very high Q. So an oscillator that uses a crystal as a series resonant tank circuit, the impedance of the crystal is minimum at the series resonant frequency, thus providing maximum feedback. The crystal tuning capacitor CC is used to fine tune the oscillator frequency. So a modified Kolpitt configuration is given here with a crystal acting as a parallel resonant tank circuit. The impedance of the crystal is maximum at parallel resonance, thus developing the maximum voltage across the capacitor. The voltage across C1 is back to the input. Next, relaxation oscillator, which is a major second type of major category of oscillator, is the relaxation oscillator. So relaxation oscillator uses an RC timing circuit and a device that changes states to generate a periodic waveform. So here you will learn about the several circuits that are used to produce non-sinusoidal waveform. That is, non-sinusoidal waveform means triangular wave, square wave and sawtooth. Thank you.